Good evening, everyone. I'd like to welcome you all to the regular scheduled council meeting for Monday, April 3rd, 2017, at 7 p.m. Mr. Collier?
Mayor Lowry?
Here.
Mr. Reynolds?
Here.
Mr. Lindsay?
Here.
Mr. Leidy?
Here.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Here.
Mr. Lethley?
Here.
Mr. Kraybauer?
Here.
All present.
Thank you, sir. And if you'll stand, we'll have tonight's invocation by Councilman John Kraybauer.
Heavenly Father, we come before you, Lord God. We pray for peace. There's many places in this world, people are looking for peace. They have none. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity that we have to serve this community, serve the people of New Carlisle. We thank you for our state representatives who are here and for the new project that we have done with the checkbook. We thank you for Susan Bayless, who's going to tell us about the Narcon. Heavenly Father, we love you. Let the Holy Spirit be with us tonight. Empower us with knowledge. In Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. We, the pledge tonight, we need to decide here.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, before we move on to the actions on the minutes for the regular scheduled council meeting, March 20th, 2017, I just want to ask, I know there's a lot of kids here tonight, if you guys have phones, just turn them down and I'll vibrate, please, if you would not mind. And also tonight, we have, I just want to announce, we have a birthday boy here tonight, Mr. Dewey.
Oh, Dewey?
I want to wish you a happy birthday.
Yeah. And how many years is it, Dewey?
Which one is it?
96. All right, so moving on, we'll need actions on the minutes for a regular scheduled council meeting March 20th, 2017.
Mr. Mayor. Second.
Mr. Kraybauer.
Motion by Mr. Kraybauer, second by Mr. Lindsay.
Correct.
Any discussion?
Council.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Leidy.
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. Lethley.
Yes.
Mr. Kraybauer.
Yes.
Mayor Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds.
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay.
Yes.
Minutes passed 7-0.
Thank you, sir. Moving on to communications tonight.
Susan Bayless, Director of Nursing from Clark County Combined Health District for Narcan discussions.
Good evening. Thank you very much for having me. My name is Susan Bayless. I'm the Director of Nursing at the Clark County Combined Health District. And I want to start off by saying I am not an expert on substance abuse. I'm not an expert on Narcan. And 10 years ago, we never would have dreamed public health would even be involved in something like this. But it has become an epidemic. And we're very heavily involved in the process right now. I want to start with just a couple statistics. First of all, on any given day at Springfield Regional Medical Center, there are 51, or any given month, there are 51 drug overdoses seen in the emergency department. In 2015, we had 73 fatal overdoses. As of 2016, just from January to August, we were already up to 52. There are still a few that need to be determined through the coroner, and we will exceed 2015's number. And 2017 is not showing any difference. It's a very scary, frightening episode. It's not Springfield, it's not Clark County, it's not New Carlisle, it's all over the United States. And there's a lot of myths about drug overdoses. you know, it's Southside Springfield and the homeless out on the streets. A couple more stats I wanted to share with you, and this is from 2015 data, but 64% were male. That these are drug deaths. 64% were males. 90.8% were white. 47.9% had never been married. 57% had a high school education. 58% were employed. 74% had a mental health history, and 83% had a history of substance abuse. So it's not the typical resident of our county that most of us picture having these issues. It's happening in every family, every socioeconomic background. So I'm sure you've all read about Narcan kits and what happens with that. So I just wanted to start out a little bit by telling you that Narcan is what we call a non-opioid antagonist, which in small terms means whatever the opioid does, Narcan's going to counteract it. So when someone either shoots up, snorts, uses a patch, all different ways to take in the opioid, if they are given Narcan, what happens when they do it, we have receptors in our brain, and this drug attaches to the receptors of the brain. What Narcan does is blow the opioid off of these receptors within so many minutes. So, and an opioid is Oxycontin, methadone, Vicodin, Percocet, fentanyl, and morphine. And I know you've all, in the good old days, morphine was the drug. If you were in severe pain, morphine would take care of it. And I have some handouts if anybody would like these, but heroin is 2 times stronger than morphine. Fentanyl, which we're all hearing about now in the news, is 100 times stronger than morphine. And the fear now, what is coming into Ohio, is carfentanil. Carfentanil is an elephant tranquilizer, and it is 10,000 times stronger than morphine. And so far, we have not seen this in Clark County, but it's here. It's here, and we will be seeing it. Fentanyl, which we've been hearing so much about, you know, I've spoke to some law enforcement officers, and I've heard, wish we could go back to the good old days of heroin, because people didn't die. You know, they overdosed. They didn't overdose. It was just an illegal drug that they were being arrested for. But now the heroin's being cut with fentanyl. And fentanyl is a synthetic drug. It's man-made. And, you know, I've explained how much more potent it is. So no one even wants to buy the heroin anymore. It's not good stuff unless it's cut with fentanyl. So we have our Narcan, or naloxone. You've probably heard it both ways. A kit, a Project Dawn kit, comes with 2 vials, 2 atomizers, and 2 face masks. That's what a Narcan kit comes with. What happens when you come across someone who has overdosed? And the sad thing is, and I think we've educated a lot of the public, we heard so many stories of, well, he was just snoring really loud, and we just thought we'd put him to bed and he'll sleep through this. Well, that's the first sign, is the struggle with breathing and the snoring, because of those brain, the receptors that it does attach to controls the breathing in a person. So that's what happens. They slowly just stop breathing. So, The Narcan that the police officers have on the street is a nasal Narcan. And this is a vial, just like, it's a syringe. I have a sample one here that didn't function properly, but it's a syringe, just like you would think if you were getting an injection. But we put an atomizer on the end. And an atomizer, it screws on the top. It looks just like this. It gets put on the top of the vial, and half of the vial is put into one nostril, the other half in the other. That is 2 milligrams worth. That's one of the syringes. Wait 2 to 3 minutes. If you see no change, that's why we have the second syringe in the case. We have been seeing cases that take up to 14, 16 doses of Narcan to bring them back. So the Narcan on the street is the atomizer. It's the nasal. It's squirted up the nose. Within the hospital, it's IV. They can give it IV, intravenous. The fear we have now, especially with the carfentanil coming into, hopefully not, but just preparing coming into Clark County, carfentanil is so strong, you can just be in a room and can experience an overdose. You don't have to inject it, you don't have to snort it. So we have the city police here in Springfield currently do not carry Narcan in their cruisers, but they are going to be carrying that now to protect themselves, not to save lives. The EMS, of course, they have it on their squad. They have numerous doses. It's scary. The coroner's office even is carrying Narcan in their cars to help when they go to call the death. They have to protect themselves. So I have a few handouts that anybody's welcome to. It explains a little bit more about the different types that are of opioids, and I also have some of the statistics. Does anyone have any questions?
No.
No questions.
I might have 100 questions, but you know, I won't ask them all. The availability of Narcan, when I checked with CVS, they say it's getting low because they can't produce it fast enough.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think you and I talked, but you said you had an ample supply, but you don't deal out to the public. If the public, can they get it from McKinley Hall, or can they get it from CVS?
Yes, there's whatever. What we call the Project Dawn. The kits are named Project Dawn, but there's actually, at McKinley Hall, they're trained to train everyday citizens, mothers, fathers, brothers, sisters. If you know you have someone in your family that they're at risk of an overdose, you go through a short training. They give you the Narcan kit to keep at your home. It's free through a grant through McKinley Hall. They're very expensive through CVS and Walgreens. Mm-hmm. I know they're like $39 for what's in this little kit right here. So right now, the health department just distributes to first responders.
Okay, you talked about cofentanil?
Carfentanil, yes.
Okay, and now, but if they take fentanyl and carfentanil, the Narcan doesn't really work, and they have not found out anything yet to counteract that. Just this weekend, several people have died, and all these young people here, that's behind you. The first thing that I would look for is to stop breathing. You talked about the breathing. Could you go on to the symptoms, talk about a little bit more about the symptoms? If I was 16, at a party, and my friend went into the bedroom, and what do I look for?
Sure. What I want to start by saying with that is the best thing you can do is never do it. Don't take that first snort. Don't do that first injection. There's the debate, is it a choice? Is it an addiction? Your first time is a choice. After that drug does change the chemicals in your brain, and after that, it's not a choice anymore. You need that. You will do anything to get that medication. But if you have a friend or a cousin, brother or sister, symptoms, cold, clammy skin, bluish lips, the snoring is the biggest one, the trouble breathing. Everybody thinks, they just need to sleep it off. Don't do it. If you cannot wake them up, if they will not talk back to you, call 911, because it's a matter of minutes before somebody, after such a length of time, if you're not breathing, you're going to have brain damage. And it's disastrous. It's horrible. So the first thing, don't start. Don't take that first dose.
Yeah. Another thing is when you give them that dose, call 911 right away.
Always.
Because of responsibility that you'll have. If you do not call 911
and they die, you could be responsible for that person.
You call 911, and the first thing they're going to tell you is start CPR, start chest compressions. You want to get the air through the body. What we hear all the time is everybody's afraid they're going to get in trouble, so they leave, they run, they go home, and the person dies. But if they call 911, there's a good Samaritan law. You are not going to be held responsible for that death. You will not, you will not be charged with anything. Please get your friend help. Get your family help.
We did pass a good Samaritan law, but one thing they did put an amendment on it, though, they're only given two things. Some of these have parties and all this stuff. You know, they're going to have it on the record the third time they were arrested.
Yeah, the person actually taking it, actually overdosing. But if you call for help, you are not going to be charged with anything that's going on in that house, from what I understand.
That's not true. Actually, the bill went through. The person that makes the phone call, if they've done it two other times, it's on record. They're in there, they're taking the drugs also.
Well, I'm saying, yeah, if you're not taking the drug, if you're just calling 911, yes. No, you will not be charged with anything. But you're right. You do get two chances.
Right. And not just the person that's over this.
Yes.
The person that's taking, if the person calling 911 is taking heroin, they can call and get help and not be charged.
Yes. Yes.
Chief?
One of the other big fallacies that we found in the county and in the city is a lot of these people have been told that, hey, if your family member or your friend is overdosing on heroin, if overdosed, take them, put them in a bathtub of cold water or ice water.
No.
No, dump. All you're going to do is kill them.
Yep. No, that doesn't, yeah. It only does damage.
We pulled several out of bathtubs.
Yes.
Yeah. But they said put them in ice water. It doesn't do anything. It shocked their heart.
Not going to do anything. You're right. Thank you.
The one thing that I learned in my training was that this is a market area. This is a test market area for the drug addicts. I want everybody to hear this. You know, when I was your age, you know, I was high most of the time. So just to tell you, I know what I'm talking about. You know, this is a test market, and it's gotten a lot worse than when I was 18 or 19. And this is a test market for peanut butter, and there's a test market for Procter & Gamble. It's also a test market for the druggies. If more people die here, that's what the drug runners want. Because the higher that you get and closer to death, that's where they want you. I'm done.
Anyone else in the audience have any questions or comments?
Council? I would just like a copy of the statistics. I want to make sure I get a copy of the statistics.
Sure, I'll leave them right here if that's okay.
Okay, thank you so much. Very informative.
No,
very.
Thank you. If anyone has additional questions, please feel free to call me at the health department, call McKinley Hall. There's help, there's people that will guide you in the right direction. Just have to ask. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Bayless. Have a good evening. We appreciate you taking your time. Come on.
Thank you for having me.
All right, moving on to discussion. Mr. Joshua Burt from the state. Dan Risco from State Treasurer's Office, Ohio Checkbook Launch. I apologize.
No, thank you, Mr. Mayor and Council, for having this evening. Good to see the young students here tonight, too. I'm glad you're here for the student discussion, but also to learn more about what your community's doing to utilize technology and really be a leader around the state in government transparency, including a lot of your schools that I'm seeing on your students here tonight. So, unfortunately, I'm going to go against the mayor and say, get out of your phones if you want, because you'll be able to follow along, so have fun. What I'm going to show you tonight is the Ohio Checkbook. New Carlisle has become the second village in the county to join the Ohio Checkbook. I'm joining six other schools, three other townships, and the Port Authority to put their spending online for taxpayers to be able to see it interactive and informative. A little background about the checkbook. Treasurer Mandel in 2014 launched the state site that you see here, and for the first time in state history, and really in national history, allowed taxpayers to see information the way they expected to be seen. Online, interactive, with this feature here, the Google style search bar. So really quick, I'll just show you a little bit about that search bar. It's an interactive search bar, so if I want to look for Department of Transportation spending, all I have to do is type in T-R-A-N-S, and Department of Transportation will pop up, but so will everything else with those letters in its name. So transfers, transportation, transit, and so on. So it's interactive, it knows what you're looking for, which beforehand, if you want to find this information, you have to ask your council, you get a static, really at the state level, you have to go to the agency and file a public records request, which might not even yield you the right information. So this is quick, it's easy, and it actually took Ohio from 46th to number one in the country in government transparency. So 50 states here near the bottom, and by launching this website, we became number one. We've actually held that ranking ever since. So after we launched the state site, feedback was very positive. Some local governments said, hey, can you guys do this for us? And so we started looking at it. Undertaking it at the state level was a big chore. It took a lot of collaboration, a lot of hard work. And so we looked at how we could do it at the local level. So we started asking, what do we have to do for this to be successful? And local government said, well, it's got to be free, because we're strapped. And we understood that, so we made it free for local governments. It's got to be easy, because a lot of our staff is part-time, and they don't have a lot of time. So we did. So we worked with the accounting providers that most of the local governments in the state use. And it's got to be voluntary, because we want this to be a good faith partnership. We don't need it to be a mandatory thing to do right now. And so we did. And so in 2015, we sent out a letter to every local official in the state, about 18,000 representing nearly 4,000 local governments. And the response has been fantastic. And I'm proud to say here today that the Ohio Checkbook now has over 1,000 local governments that are committed to partnering with us on this program. And that number continues to grow each week. So I'll go ahead and show you the local government platform. What we did was we basically offered the same functionality to local governments that we provided for the state's benefit. So here you see a map of Ohio. The little bubbles represent, I'm sorry guys, you can't see, but bubbles represent all the different communities that are currently online. You're able to drill down into this map, as well as search for communities right here on the search bar. But we've also listed off every local government that's online down here below. And you can see here that under the cities and villages, there's New Carlisle. And there is the website. So New Carlisle, village display 1 year spending, totaling $4.9 million. We have it broken down by your departments. So everything on here is interactive, all the bars and graphs. So I'm gonna sit down real quick and just show you a quick overview. So all these graphs, all these bar graphs, everything you scroll over is actually a chunk of spending for that month. So if I were to scroll over here, Twin Creeks assessment, $265,000. Street spending in October 2016, $34,000. But I'm also able to come over here and click on a specific department just off a ledger. So let's say I want to look at swimming pool spending. One second. Yep.
Oh, wow.
I got it.
I know what that means.
Yeah, we did an awesome job.
When did we spend 10 or something?
That's the Russians.
When did we spend 10 or
something? The Russians.
The Russians.
All right,
we're back. All right. Did we send 20 grades one big payment?
There we go. And you see the checks that were written in each individual month. So May, June, July, August, make sense. Those are full months. But that doesn't necessarily show you where that money's going, which a lot of times is what people ask for, what people might ask the finance department for. So we have this feature called Broken Down By. And what we can do is actually change over to the vendor name and show the biggest chunks of spending on just the swimming pool. So over here on the right, you see all the vendors that the village used to help pay up for the swimming pool department. So let's say I just want to see what they spent on Menards. All you have to do is click. And down here, we have an actual check ledger that are showing the checks that were written for that particular check. And if I click on it, you get a real check image with the actual information about that payment. So a payment made at Menards on May 12th of last year, the actual check number, the amount, and what it was for, the maintenance of facilities, in this case being the swimming pool. So just a few seconds, you're able to access all that information without having to take up staff time, without having to put in a public records request, just by simply accessing on this website. The other feature that I mentioned, that Google style search bar, you want to go back up here to the top and type in an object, like supplies, equipment, what have you. All you have to do is start typing. And just like we had on the state site with the Google style search, everything that has these characters in its name come up. So in this case, concession supplies at the swimming pool, medical supplies, office supplies for council. You want to click on that. Looks like just one payment for Staples credit plan, only $100. So over here, the village decided, Carlisle's decided to put up a couple of commonly asked questions, how much does the city spend on pension payments for the cost of maintaining the swimming pool, and how much have they spent on the swim creeks assessment. So if I want to just look at the assessment, that's an automatic search, and it comes up and it'll show you all the spending related to that, to the swim creeks assessment. Each time you go back, like you do, hit reset. And as I mentioned, we're looking at $4.9 million over roughly 5,100 transactions. In this program, we've always talked about how people are either going to be leaders or followers. We have over 1,000, we have over a quarter of the local governments in the state on. So I'm really proud to be here in Clark County tonight, because I think this county really led the charge. This area, really, between Clark and Green, they were some of the first ones to adopt the checkbook, and you guys, you know, are following suit here tonight. I'm really happy to be here. It's also kind of curious timing that just last week, Springfield Schools actually declined a checkbook demonstration. They didn't decline to join the checkbook. They declined to even have us in for a demonstration. They actually wrote us a letter saying that they respectfully declined, which is fine. It's their right. But, you know, with so many other schools in the county online, you know, the city joining today, Springfield Township itself being online, you know, it just goes to show that sometimes people view transparency in different ways. That's why I'm proud to be here in New Carlisle tonight to join with you guys as leaders and launching this. So I'm happy to answer any questions. I just really appreciate you guys having me here tonight and for being a partner with us on this program.
Councilman, any questions? Administration side.
Utilization. Will you guys be able to keep track of that in a 6 month or a year of utilization hits, visits?
Where they're going from? Okay. So the administration actually is able to access a back end on where they can see searches, who's searching or what they're searching, where they're physically located. So obviously not user, but you know, the coding on your browser, they can show whether it's me in Columbus or citizens here. As well as a 7, 30, and 90 day look at how many searches you've had and what they're searching for.
How often does this information get updated online? I'm assuming that depends on our financial director,
correct? To you guys, yeah. It's okay. A partnership. You know, we are able to help update as often as you guys want. Obviously, there's some stuff we have people that do quarterly, more frequently, yearly. So it really depends on the local government what they decide.
Anyone in the audience have any questions or comments on this? Not a one.
Yes, sir. How far back will that actually go? I mean, like 5 years down the road, will it still come all the way back to today?
Sure. It's really up to the local government how much information they want from us. Some of the schools and townships, you'll see a couple of years, because we built in a yearly patch for the townships. Schools do it more on the fiscal year. It's really up to the local government, sorry.
Now, does the city have, like, unlimited space, for example, just like she was saying? So in 10 years, does things start falling off after you went so far ahead?
No, they don't. Okay. If you look at some of the other cities, one that comes to mind is kind of the extreme. I shouldn't say it. Huber Heights, just down the road, they have over 10 years, I believe. City of Norwalk up in Huron County, they have, I think, 15. Okay. And that holds true for every local government. So as much information as you want to provide, we can post on this website. Mm-hmm.
You're talking about backside being able to see who does searches. Does there happen to be a front page hit meter or anything?
No, that's actually a good idea. We've considered that. That might be something we do with version 2.0. I can tell you at the state level, we've got over 730,000 in just a little over 2 years. So it's gotten its uses for sure. And, you know, I was just over at a township today up in her updater site, and she had, I think, 16 searches in 7 days or something. And she, wow, I didn't realize people were using this. So just because they're not asking doesn't mean they're not looking. So this is a really great tool for citizens and the administration, council to use. And it's available anytime. So even though there's nobody at the office, if you're at home, you want to look up something, you can go online, use it, find a question to raise a council next meeting.
And the financial director, can you update information on your own, or does she have to go through you?
We can do it both ways. So okay. Our office is always available to help. We do have, you know, tutorials and things that will come out and help show you how. So.
Okay.
Anything 50,000 or more has to go through the controlling board.
Correct.
Correct. Okay. And so that's that. There's still another system behind this.
Okay.
But the governor was the two airplanes. We're not real happy.
That's another conversation.
Yeah, really.
Another conversation. Mr. Lynn, that's the council.
Ms. Harris, I'm so glad you can name your name. How often do you think, thank you, I couldn't see it, there's a representative in the way.
There you go.
How often are you planning on updating checkbook?
I'll take that. We will do it once a year, at the end of every year.
Just once a year? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Is there any plans in the future of maybe doing it quarterly or something to have more information?
The reason we'll do it once a year is reviewing time it takes. So once you get the data up there, to go through a whole year's worth of data to review it. But first and foremost, I think our citizens need to realize the most transparent level of government is here at your local level. At any point in time, they can walk right into the office and get the information that they need. But since we are very short staffed, it will be doing it probably about more, at least once a year. So when you get into quarterly stuff, it's just too much for you to do. You'd rather just sit down once a year and get it done.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
Mr. Owens.
I just want to thank Dan for coming out. I worked with Josh Burton on this, and also with the state treasurer when this first came out. And I think it's a great step for us. I mean, as you can see, you can click on anything and figure out what we're spending money on. So you see all this stuff on Facebook that we're wasting money or buying these extravagant things. This will prove what we're spending our money on.
What's the access?
It's all live. It's a public.
No, I mean, what is the site?
Oh, newcarlisle.ohiocheckbook.com. And that's, just so everybody knows, every URL is custom, so if you guys want to put it on the website, tweet it out, what have you, it's your website. So we provide the URL to each local government, but it is your website.
Did you say .com or .org?
.com.
And could you talk for a minute about the fact that there's a bill that I'm co-sponsoring in the House to put this into the higher revised code? We have to do this. This is something that the state treasurer did, but it does not have to be continued.
Correct.
Can you talk about that?
Correct. Yeah, I'll talk high level about that. So we introduced the bill several times now to make this a function of the treasurer's office even after Treasurer Mandel leaves office. So Treasurer Mandel's made transparency top priority of his administration since he took office, but he doesn't want it to end when he goes. So we've introduced a bill that would make the Ohio checkbook a function of the treasurer's office even after for future treasurers. And so we feel strongly that taxpayers deserve to have this information to click their fingertips. We also feel that this being the number one ranked website in the country 2 years in a row says that other people are looking at us and saying, I was doing right. So the more local governments like New Carlisle we get online, and the more help we get, the more recognition that this program gets, the stronger we feel this should be continued even after President Mandel's term. So
when we started the bill, I mean, way back, it took a while. You know, I was really good sponsor, but at the last minute, DAS, which is the huge department administrative services, they made another push.
All I know is, you know, we've done it out of the treasurer's office. It's been number one for 2 years now. We're going to continue to work on it and, you know, make it number one, keep it number one. That's our goal, keep it number one. But should give credit to Senator Hackett, now back to his representative Hackett. I remember we were at a the Madison County Chamber 2 years ago. He's going around local officials in the room going, you should do this, you should do this. So thank you for all of being there for us and supporting us.
Ms. Harris, just out of curiosity, or either one of you wants to answer this, how long would it take to do, like, this time next year, if you, when you went to update it? How much time, days, hours does it take to upload a complete ballpark idea?
Their upload took probably an hour at our meeting. To review, I've spent quite a bit of time.
Okay.
And it is, like I said, not as the highest priority when we have other audits going on that are mandated for my time. So we did, we really put the time in to get it up and going and see how it goes.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, so like I said, we worked with the accounting systems to make the exporting very easy, but as Harris said, review time, that's their department, to speak to what they're covering. So we're just happy that you guys are working with us and appreciate the partnership.
Any other questions?
Yeah, you said you are a touch base for local schools. Are you doing the same thing with charter schools?
We are. Bill is our professor.
How many of them turned it down?
Turned it down?
Kind of wrong, but
I believe there are, I'd have to get you the exact number. Yeah. But so there's over 200 schools that have committed to doing this right now. So. Pause. No, I'm sorry, all around. I'm sorry. 200 total schools, school districts that are, and charter schools that are committed to this.
Thank you, sir. All right, any other questions before we move on?
No.
All right, thank you, sir. We appreciate you coming out tonight and explaining that. It looks wonderful.
Thank you.
All right, we'll be moving on to the City Manager's Report. Mr. Bridge, good evening.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council, members of the public. Always, it's great to see a good turnout today. Since it is the first meeting of April, we do kind of got a short city manager's report. We do need a motion to approve Ms. Christine Walker as a Board of Zoning Appeals member. Her application is attached. Before you guys go on that motion, I would like to kindly say that we still have a few vacancies left on some of our boards. We have one vacancy on the Tax Board of Review, and we also have two vacancies on the Civil Service Commission. So you do need to be at least 18 years of age to be on these boards, and you do need to be a resident of New Carlisle. On Wednesday, what I'll do is go ahead and repost this information again on Facebook. But we did, we still need a few more volunteers for these two boards. But in the meantime, if council could so kindly make a motion to approve Ms. Walker to the BZA.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Reynolds.
I move that we appoint Christine Walker to the Board of Zoning Appeals.
Second.
Mr. Leffley, I think.
Was Mr. Reynolds the first?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds made the motion. Mr. Leffley the second.
Ready for a vote?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Krabacher?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Leidy?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Leffley?
Yes.
Ms. Christine Walker is appointed 7-0.
Thank you, sir.
Ready to go? And also attached with the council packet is the Clark County Springfield Transportation Coordinated Committee, also known as the PCC. We'll be having open house right here in the shelter house on April 5th from 4 p.m. to 6 p.m. And what it is, it's for the federal TIP program, which is a list of all the federally backed road projects that are infrastructure projects going on in Clark County over the next 4 years. So they'll have a bunch of maybe graphs and some maps of what they're going to be doing. And it's just a Q&A session, essentially. You can go look at the projects, give members of TCC your feedback back. They do this, I think, every year as part of the requirement. Always interesting to come see that. And also attached is a income tax assist date. So if you need help filing your city taxes for this year, on Saturday, April 8th from 2 p.m. to 6 p.m. at our fire station, we will have not only members of city staff there, but also a couple members from CCA who we did outsourcing our income tax collection with. They will sit down with you and help you fill out your taxes. We had one a couple of weeks ago, and it was a decent turnout. We look to build on that. So again, tell your mom and dad, anyone needs help with their taxes and you are a resident of New Carlisle, please go to the fire station on Saturday from 2 p.m. to 6 p.m. to get assistance. That is all I have. Mr. Kitko would like to mention something real quickly.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge. Good evening, Mayor, Council members of the public. This week, starting tomorrow through the 7th, the city water crews will be testing the operations of our two water storage towers. So for your safety, we will be monitoring the pressure and flows during this time. So if you experience any kind of odd pressures or flows that basically go down to a trickle, you definitely can call our water superintendent at their office. We have a cell listed at 604-2101. Or you can call me on my cell, 604-2116, if you have any kind of issues at your house. That's just going to be this week. We're doing most of the work during normal business hours, so there shouldn't be any after-hours stuff, but it will be on the city's Facebook page. It is on the city's Facebook page. I'm going to pass this over to the news and anybody else that wants to get this information out. But it's just some of the things that we'll have to be doing prior to any of the work being done on the tower. That's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Alan, what was the date and time of that?
Between tomorrow and April 7th. Tomorrow and Friday.
That is tomorrow. All I have, sir.
Tomorrow through Friday or just tomorrow and Friday?
Tomorrow through Friday.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Bridge, Mr. Kitko. And moving on to comments from the members of the public. If anyone in the audience has any questions or comments tonight, this would be your time to go to the podium. And we would need your name and address before you, or when you do so.
Donna Kugler, 909 West Washington Street. I want to thank Howie and the city manager and the guys, definitely, for coming out and taking that tree down that was laying on the power line over here by my house. We're in the rain, it's almost the time, and they did it anyways. So I really appreciate that. One of the main reasons I'm up here tonight is because the four-wheeler issue is rising its head again. I want to know, do we need to talk about that, or will somebody handle it?
Mr. Bridge or Mr. Kitko? Of course, I don't know what to say about that because I don't know anything about it.
The four-wheelers running down here in on city property and inside city limits. Pardon?
By the bike path?
And up through here, yes.
Have we gotten reports on that lately?
Deputy Cruz gave me a call today about that. I need to revisit there's an ordinance in place before I was a city manager. Anybody can answer. If they're on their own property, because Deputy Cruz said she was on their property. So I think it's just a matter of where they're riding, but I literally just got the phone call today. So.
I believe it's a matter of they're in city limits. We went through this, we've got ordinances. I brought them with me if you guys would like to look at. I didn't make you copies because they cost money. But I brought them, you can look at them or you can write down the numbers and look them up yourself.
Do you have that ordinance number, ma'am?
13-49 and 51.
And that was Miguel's, so he was all time.
Yeah, Miguel.
Okay.
I also wrote down the number that it's actually in the ordinance. Now that number I gave you is where you voted on it.
Presented
to council. Mm-hmm. And I'm not gonna burn up a whole bunch of time on that because if I did call, the officer came down, she went and talked to him. They got angry, made a whole lot of noise for about a half hour, 45 minutes, and then they went away. So if they don't come back, we're good. Bell Manor, I guess I take it you're proceeding ahead on acquiring that building, even though the citizens didn't feel any support for that. Is that correct?
I mean, I can't speak for everyone up here, but I mean, we are taking steps to work towards that, yes.
Okay, well, we didn't know where that was at. And the water tower thing, I wanted to know, somebody said something about it has to be self-supporting, and I was curious, why is that? I mean, is that an ordinance here? I don't know, somebody here said it, and also Greg Slattery said that to me.
You're talking about the fund for the water?
Self-supporting, yeah. I mean, right. is that a city thing, or is it a written rule, or is it a state law? I mean, I don't know what that is.
Oh, I see.
Ohio revised code required.
It's Ohio revised code?
Can Ms. Harris, do you mind adding on to that, or do you not want to?
I don't have the code to quote, and I can look it up, but yes, the Interfop Price funds the water, which is water and sewer, of two of those, are to be paid for all the expenses out of the revenue that we collect for those services. They are supposed to be self-supporting. Although the general fund is a fund that can contribute as a loan, is to help other funds. The water department and the sewer department is supposed to be able to maintain its own expenditures.
Okay. Online council packets only go back to May the 2nd of 16, and I can't read my own. The meetings actually go back to April 17th of 2014, but there's no packets with that. That's just YouTube. What I would like to know is, where are the archives for the city for all the past, you know, like council packets, ordinances, how they were voted on, how they were reviewed, what they said. Anything has to do with what has been passed in the past that's not accessible online.
I assume up until a certain date, I don't know what the date is, that it would be able to be found in the city office.
No, council agendas, I don't know what former city manager did with them. All mine are on my computer, since I put them together. The reason why it starts under a city web page at a certain date, because that's when we started collecting them. Council videos on YouTube have been going well before we started doing the archive. And the archive was a request of a citizen, so that's why we started doing that. Council minutes are always on file at the city building. Council agendas prior to 2014, I don't know where they're prior to me taking over. So council agendas are really not required to be on display. It's just really the minutes of what was said. So as long as we have the minutes there, you should be able to get what we got off of the meeting based off the minutes.
Yeah, all the agenda comes in. The agenda is actually in the minutes. So if you look at the minutes, you can see what the agenda actually was.
Well, but from 16 to 14, there's only YouTube, or you got the packets, but before 14, you have no packets, it has no information, so there's no real minutes.
The minutes are on file at the city building in big books that we keep.
Journal.
So they're big books that every time that he gets some of the minutes, we put them in there. So those go back to, I think we got, many years.
I actually have one right here that is
from 1981.
December 91 and 1983, September 1983.
Where'd you get those at?
They're at the city building.
City building.
You have to request those. So if you want those, you say, hey, can I have
On record.
Can I have this meeting from this date? And we'll go pull it, make a copy, and then give it to you.
You're not going to give me a copy of what I'm after, because I'm after a lot of information.
Mm-hmm.
And I know you're not going to want to print that out. I mean, I don't care if you do. I don't have a problem.
Well, if you print out too much, then you take it with you, then you have to pay a per copy charge.
Well, what I'm saying is, how can I, as a citizen of New Carlisle, access the records of, like, say, all the ordinances that's been passed?
Well, all the ordinances can be found online.
Yes, all of our ordinances are online. Our city charter, I look at it pretty regularly. It's under American Legal Journal Publishing, LexisNexis.
If you want like 91, 92, I get you on that. Let me know what years you want. I will go pull the books. And how that works is, you go to the city building, you sit in the lobby, and you can have that book with you. You can make notes. You can do whatever you want with that particular book. You can't take the book with you, but you can sit there and write down notes. But if you're looking for something that's searchable online, so you can just sit at your house and pull these things up, the only farthest we go back is to when we started keeping an archive on the thing. Now, you came to the office and I said, if you want to search for the minutes, it's the council packet. So those minutes, if you're looking for last week's meetings minutes, they're going to be on this packet.
Am I allowed to be talking to him now? I just read, I'm not supposed to be talking directly to him.
If we allow it, you're allowed.
So I just have to get your permission then, but I can ask you questions if I get your permission.
But let me, I spent a lot of time in the genealogy room at the library, and they have a lot of information. We have to search. You know, it's not something you get in 15 minutes sometimes because of not really good order, but they're fixing. But the genealogy room at the library carries a lot of our stuff. Of our really long ago, and also old newspapers too.
Mr. Lowry.
You're not going to give me what I want.
Mrs. Cooper.
Yes.
You and I have always been straight up with each other.
That's right. We have.
I'm going to ask you a question.
Go ahead.
What are you looking for?
I am looking for, and I have it somewhere, and I could find it at home probably quicker than I find it somewhere else, and that's saying a lot. But I am looking for when we put it on the ballot for part of the income tax to go to that school over there, and then we were put under fiscal watch. And that money, they put $100,000 in the roof, and that's as far as that ever went. And I want to go back and research that.
Okay, that
what
is
year was that?
Record.
That would be in the minutes.
Yeah.
What year was that?
I probably have them at home. I would swear to it because I know I moved. And but I didn't have them. That, yeah, you can.
Well, you're like me. Yeah, I got them, but.
Well, no, I'm not sure I do have them because we moved, and you know, some things got thrown away. But I researched that myself and read every one of them.
You will forget
it's
me,
definitely
right?
Available.
I want to go back and research that section where KD and I hung out together, where we carried the petitions and got the recalls on the ballots for the council members, and we got rid of Kaplinger, and we also passed.
No, city council got rid of.
Well, yeah, but we got rid of part of the council that didn't want to get rid of it. So, but anyways, I want to know. What I want to know is, where did that money go, and why was it never paid back, and why did it never go to that school? So I don't know who to contact with the state to find out what happened, or if they even know what happened, but I want to know what happened.
Okay.
So anything you can come up with on that would be wonderful. Okay, that's a big one. That's a big one on this my list here. And then on this Ohio checkbook thing, it's only going to go back 1 year. So is that starting what date? Today? I mean, today, and then it won't be updated again till.
I would say, Ms. Harris, that would get updated again a year from now.
We've got the whole calendar year of 2016.
That's what I wasn't understanding. Because it sounded like we just initiated today, but we're really not going to be on. Like, if I want to look at something from two months ago, is it already on there?
Just 2016, from January 1 through December 31st, when we got the end of the year closed.
2016.
And we worked on doing the pot.
So you're a year in arrears, basically?
You have to, yeah.
We have to
create it before you can show it. So we decided to do a whole calendar year so it's not broken up in bits and pieces. So we have 2016 posted the whole year.
So and whatever happens, like say with the water, well, that's, anyways. If something happens that somebody wants to know, 6 months ago, where did that money go, or how did that get paid for, or whatever. I mean, so you still have to wait till next year to find out what happened this year.
No, you can go to the city office and get, you know, her packets, her financial reports that come out every month are on our website from, you know, a few months back all the way to the future. So they're just as detailed as, you know, they got the check registry, so you could find out what checks were spent where and how much and all that.
Well, like what we got in that budget thing, when you read it down, it's kind of vague about what it's really telling you the money went for. It just is generalized, and I wanted to see. Because it looked like you could click on what he had, and it would get more specific about.
It can't be any more specific than what she's putting in.
Right.
And it's coming off of a check that she's writing, so it can't be more specific than that check.
Well, can we get more specific than that?
How much more specific can you get?
Well,
if you get an invoice for $12 and you pay $12, you're done.
if you spend $5,000 on a swimming pool, but then break it down into how much of it went into the water department, went into the water department, then how do you know that?
It's broken down.
Broken down.
I must have missed it then, because I looked for that when they did the budget on the swimming pool to see how much we spent on water the last time, because the last we talked about, I know my time's up, the last we talked about it, the pool was leaking like 4,000 gallons a week. And I don't even know if it's fixed or whatever. But I give you, that's enough for right now, but Rick, I'm counting on you to come through.
No, I told you, I don't know if I have them, but I can steer you in the right direction to get what you want. I don't know if I physically have them anymore. I told you that. I'm really going to, I don't know, but I did have them because I went through all that with you, read up on it. And that's from 98, 99.
Yeah, you're right. That's about right. You see, I don't know exactly. Yep. It's somewhere between 98 and 2000.
It's 98, 99.
All right, thank you very much. Sorry, I ran over my time.
Thank you.
Put a nickel in the box when you leave to pay for it.
Okay. Anyone else?
Hi.
Name and address, please.
My name is Becky McKenzie, and I'm at 521 Hamilton. And I have a couple of questions for a few council members, and I have some questions about some social media content. So the first question is for Ethan. At the last city council meeting, you said that you proposed several cuts to the budget that weren't approved, and I was wondering
excuse
what
me.
Those were.
Can we turn something up, because I cannot hear what you said.
She has to
turn. Oh, you have to turn. I'm sorry.
That's okay. I just wanted to know what the cuts were that you suggested.
Seasonal work I had suggested during that meeting. We had a work session prior to the actual council meeting, which all of us were here, and I think we had like a good, we had two of them, they were each about 3 hours. So seasonal, cutting down what we were spending on the pool, because the pool had ended up doing much better than anyone projected. I mean, it's a huge list, I would definitely give it to you. There's just some that I remember off the top of my head.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And then Bill, you had said last meeting that you wanted to see a 10% reduction in all departments. How do you feel like that would be possible?
Well, the budget from the year before, this year, was increased by $100,000 from 2016. Mm-hmm. I think we could have lived with the same budget we had in 2016, which would have eliminated the seasonal workers. I think in 2016 we spent, and I'm just kind of off the top of my head, around $350-some, I think. For seasonal, the year before, I think it was like $500 for seasonal. So there's things like that. The pool, another one, the pool did excellent last year. We could have cut that down a little bit more than what was cut, or what was that, $35,000 now. I think we could have done that at $25,000 or $30,000 to start off with. That would have been a $5,000 to $10,000 savings there. Just things like that. I know. A comment was made last meeting that, you know, I was wanting to cut wages. Wages are negotiated. Can't cut wages, can't cut insurance. It's all union contracts, which we can't do anything with that. But the discretionary spending, like seasonal help and, you know, things along that line, we can control that.
Who would do the work that the seasonal people do if we didn't hire them?
They haven't done it in 3 years.
Last year,
it was just a question.
Yeah,
just a question.
Last year, like Mr. Reynolds said, for the last 3 years, we didn't have seasonal help. Mm-hmm. So the city workers did it, and I had comments last year that the parks and stuff looked great, and we didn't have seasonal help.
Do we have less workers doing those things now than we did then?
Not to my knowledge, but don't we have the same staff that we had last year, don't we, Mr. Britt? I mean, nobody got laid off that I'm aware of.
No, but when the city was going through some budget issues, I think we reduced the amount of seasonal workers, but we got a slew of complaints about how bad the grass looked. Our seasonal workers are hired to cut grass, essentially. You know, so when you take that component out of this equation, there's always a reaction for an action. And that particular reaction would be, again, the grass would be not in the shape it's in, namely the cemetery. You know, so if you want a standard of appearance, especially when it comes to seasonal work, your seasonal workers are the best bang for your buck that you possibly could have. We could definitely hire no seasonal workers, but we're going to have to hire a full-time staff member that also includes a full range of benefits and time off. So I think when it comes down to cutting seasonal workers, I think a benefit versus what you're getting out of that needs to be addressed and looked at too. And it needs to be heavily researched because our street guys currently, we don't have enough street guys to keep up with mountain grass that cuts, especially early in the spring, especially around Memorial Day when we got so many people come to the cemetery. You know, so to say to cut seasonal workers, it's a risk because what's going to happen is things are going to not get done in a timely manner. And one thing that doesn't get done in a timely manner is grass cutting. And grass cutting doesn't stop growing because we don't have people to cut it.
Well, we're elected to take those risks. You know, you're part of the administration. We are elected to take those risks. And you know what? Seasonal workers there, the budget passed, the last meeting. So that's where we're at.
Okay, and then as far as the social media comments, Ethan, you specifically, you posted a meme on your Facebook page a few weeks ago that said, no heart, no brain, no courage. And then you said, unfortunately, many local politicians have this problem. Were you speaking of your fellow council members?
Oh, I have no problem. We obviously have vast disagreements on many different issues. So, yeah, I think, you know, with the great example, the open checkbook. You know, we had that when that letter came to us in 2013, and with Kim Jones, she was here. I recommended it. Nothing.
But Kim Jones isn't here anymore.
Oh, but no, but there's a point to this. Some members said no or didn't support that idea.
Mm-hmm.
So I pushed it, campaigned on it in 2015, got reelected, and now it's here. So yeah, there are some members that I wholeheartedly disagree with and would like to see them be more conservative. I think Bob would agree with me. I'm very conservative, and I like to push hole in that issue, no matter what it is. Mm-hmm. So yeah.
Well, which one of us are brainless, spineless, and don't have a heart?
And have no courage.
I have no courage.
Have no courage is not voting to fail the budget at the original point.
When would they have needed to fail the budget to show courage?
Showing courage is
so that's you.
Well, let me. Yeah. Well, no. I only voted on one budget. I'm saying in previous budgets. I'm not saying in this exact one. The only reason we had to pass this one was simple. And it was either we did or we had shut down, and there would be no services. So yeah, I mean.
So everyone had to pass it. So no one was courageless in that moment, correct?
In different budgets, people have been. Yeah. I mean,
okay.
We're obviously on this separate.
So the
here.
Reason why I'm asking is because I feel like at the last meeting, what was the woman that was over there last time talking with the budget? She had been talking about how important it is for city council to work together and to work with city management. And I find that you and Bill particularly don't work together with the rest of the council or management. I saw pictures about a proclamation that you did, and you didn't include anybody else on the council. You posted a picture of just yourself and those people. You didn't tell anybody else that that was happening. Why would you do that?
Because that proclamation was coming from my office as a city councilman. Mm-hmm. Now, that's changing because the mayor put forth an ordinance to change mm-hmm. that. And if it passes, it passes. If it doesn't, it doesn't.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
But I mean, like, if you want everyone in the city to be included in those things, why wouldn't you include that with the whole council and make it something that everyone can
celebrate.
Right.
I will share my schedule with them when they share their schedule with me.
It's not about a schedule.
Oh,
it's just about
if I'm
like,
releasing something from my office, ma'am, then it would be part of my schedule.
It was,
so I would like
it
to know
said
when
city council,
well,
and it was you and Bill were there, and nobody else was invited. So I'm just curious about that.
Well, that's up to our prerogative to choose how we dictate our schedules. If we want to release a proclamation or ordinance or resolution, we don't have to get approval. I mean,
I'm not saying you have to get approval.
I didn't know that there was an ordinance coming up to allow only the mayor to hand out a proclamation. I mean, should I have known
No, I
that?
Mean, wouldn't
so
it be
it's
nice
okay
if the whole
wait,
council
so it's okay if
was
Mr.
involved.
Lowry and other members choose to do things without approval of Bill and I.
I didn't
but
say that.
But without Bill and I giving them approval, oh, there's a problem.
No, that's not
a
what I said.
Liberal media spin.
I said that I prefer that all of you work together. Because what I'm finding is that when you do things like that, and when you say, like, drain the swamp in New Carlisle, you're talking about people that have been working for the city for many years,
yeah.
have invested in the city, And when you say things like that, it's very disrespectful.
Well, I'm sorry, but that's, I was elected twice now. I had them in first place. You know, the voters chose that sort of attitude, just like the voters chose President Trump. And
unfortunately,
well, that's your opinion. But guess what? He still won. He's our president.
That's
so
right.
If you don't like it, go to the ballot box and vote.
Well, I just wanted to make sure that people understood that you were doing those things.
Uh-huh.
And that a lot of other people don't know that you're doing those things.
Oh, they're more than welcome to go
so
check
much.
Out my social media.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Lawler,
question. You just stated that we've, I guess, I'm sorry, not you, Ethan, that council has left you and Bill out. I don't ever remember a proclamation being made when you were not sitting here, and I've never heard you say, no, that should not be done. Ethan, it's constant. You know, Facebook. I voted no on this, but you didn't put at the bottom, so did every other council member. You know? And that's what it's all about. I agree with you 100%. You know, you tell a whole lot of half-truths. I'll tell you, I'll tell the world. If you don't like it, I'm sorry, that's the way it is. And a whole lot of people know about you.
Good thing that's your opinion.
No, that's a fact. Many times. I mean, let's kind of look at it this way. If you're on Facebook and you block every other council member,
that's
talk
funny.
About
that
them, what does that say?
That's funny. That mine is completely public. Anyone can get on at any time, even yourself, Mr. Lowry, or Mike. He's not blocked. He actually is in my friend queue right now. I'll gladly accept him, but anyone can go. Anybody.
All I'm saying is that you work better together when you're nice to each other and respectful and you can get things done in the city and you can talk about how to get people to invest their money and their future into the city, not by dividing people and not by saying that you're doing something that someone else isn't. There's no reason for it. This is city council. This is to make me feel out. Dry. You know, it's not about politics. It's just about getting stuff done.
Yeah, Ethan, it's not, you know, Democrat and Republican. It never has been. And until you came on, it never was.
Okay, so let me touch on something real quick. I was gonna save it to the end, but since the young lady brought it up and you mentioned it, on the proclamation issue, you know, and I admit I was as shocked as anybody or some people when I'd seen the door proclamations being given out throughout the city with no one on the council or administration side knowing about it. Is it wrong or legal? I don't know, I guess it depends on who you ask. I don't think it's illegal. I think it's unethical, yes. Do I think it's unprofessional? Yes. I'd had a lady from the Cubs football team who gave a proclamation to it, and she called me and she said, she was a mother of the team, and she said, why did no one else on city council recognize the Cubs? And I was like, what are you talking about? She's like, well, we got a proclamation. I said, from who? Mr. Reynolds and Mr. Lindsay. And I was like, well, I said, no one else knew about it. I said, so I guess, you know, that's the way they're going to handle it, and that's the way they're going to handle it. Fast forward to a week or so ago, I stopped in Stagecoach Cafe on my way to work, and I wanted to get a sandwich. And the lady who owns the place, she was, you know, I was ordering my food. Are you going to come in tomorrow morning? For what? She's like, I'm getting a proclamation from Mr. Reynolds. I'm assuming this. And I, you know, and I explained to Andrew, guys. I said, you know, look. I said, I don't know what to tell you about this. I said, in the history I've known in this city, long before I was on council, proclamations are always done in a public meeting with all the elected officials and the administration, the public, the cameras, the news, and the minutes. And importantly, because those people then get maximum recognition for those types of things. You know, they're permanently in minutes that are going to be around for, you know, who knows, the Dave McGorder of, you know, 2050 is going to look up some restaurant and say, well, did they get a proclamation? Well, it's not in minutes. I just think it's not handled right because you're kind of watering down the proclamation and kind of, in my opinion, cheating them out of the whole experience. Just my opinion. And that's, you know, I don't want to have to, we don't want to have to make rules and hold people by the hands, but I mean, I don't see why anyone would go outside of council to do that. It just doesn't really make sense. So.
What with the proclamations? The administration did know I was writing them.
Proclamation is administration. I have no say in proclamation.
Yeah.
Proclamations typically come from the office.
Exactly. He said the administration didn't know, which would obviously not be correct. So for factual, for just for fact,
I'm sorry.
He didn't know.
I'm not arguing. I'm just stating my position because that did bother me. I mean, yeah.
Will he vote to pass or fail this ordinance? Well,
and it's not because I'm the mayor and I get to give the proclamation. If it was John or Mr. Lowry or Mr. Whitey in 5 years, 2 years, that's who should be doing it right here. So the person that's getting the proclamation gets the full experience of it and what they deserve. And it's put on minutes for history to be able to research for years to come. So my two cents.
Same thing, just to kind of piggyback off of it. I'm not to beat a dead horse, but you know, as a former business owner in this town, I felt sick to my stomach that, you know, I once showed up on Saturday morning too, just because I felt bad. Yeah, I would be humiliated if somebody came to me and said, hey, we're going to give you a proclamation, and I would feel so honored, but then only to find out that it's just from somebody possibly trying to make themselves look good and not getting everyone else involved. And, you know, I'm not trying to say that's your motive, but it could be. I don't know why else you would not get anybody else involved. And I think that really does need to end. So hopefully when we vote it gets everybody involved.
Mr. Lowry, you took some of the words right out of my mouth in those instances, and I stand behind my words and I will say what I think. The proclamation was not for Stagecoach Cafe. The proclamation was not for, and I repeat, was not for the Cubs. It was for the people presenting the proclamation. That's exactly what it was all about. I don't care if you like it or don't like it. That's the fact. You know it. I know it.
Fact opinion.
And I think a whole lot of
I think you're kind of getting confused with what fact and opinion is, but that's okay.
All right, let's move on. And anyone else from the public that has any questions or comments before we move on, this is your chance. All right, thank you very much. All right, we are moving on.
Did you miss someone? I'm sorry.
No.
Did you raise your hand? No. Mr. Cook. Huh. I'm sorry. I thought I saw you reach out. Thought you.
Okay. All right. Moving on to committee reports. None tonight. We'll go on to resolutions. Three introduced tonight.
Mr. Collier, ready?
Yes, resolution 17-05R, introduction, public hearing, and action tonight. A resolution showing support of the Immigration and Nationality Act.
Council.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Reynolds.
To approve resolution 17-05R. Second.
What was that, Mr. Whitey, on the second? Normally, I would give an explanation of any resolution or ordinances after council does the first and second motion to approve. But in this case, we have a unique situation to where a councilman actually introduced legislation to be passed. Since this is a policy-oriented thing, administration don't get involved in policy. Council sets policy. So we'll let Mr. Lindsay so kindly describe his resolution.
And this resolution is basically to work with law enforcement on any illegal persons or activity in the city to as far as immigration, people that comes in illegally, that cost our city money, that cost our county money. They also are responsible for a lot of the crime and stuff. But it's just saying that we're going to work with law enforcement, county, state, federal, to keep some of the illegals out of New Carlisle. Legal immigration. We're good with that. We're open for business for them. We welcome them. But the illegal activity and stuff from illegal that are here illegally is not to be tolerated. We don't want to be a sanctuary city like Dayton, Columbus. I believe Cleveland's also a sanctuary city. The president has said that the sanctuary cities will lose money. They will stop their federal funding.
Okay, hold on, guys. Go ahead, Mr. Lindsay. Did you finish?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Gray Barker.
Okay. My one question for you, Bill, is where's your statistics
you know, that this is going to help New Carlisle, or the statistics that this is in New Carlisle, and why, you know, what's the real purpose of this?
The statistics fell out of my folder. I was laying it into my folder, yeah. My office, or someplace between there and my car.
Well, there probably is no statistics for New Carlisle. There's no, you know, that'd be my guess. Now, it'd probably be national statistics, yes. But you talk about one shooting by one illegal, but it could be.
I think we've had more than that within the state.
Well, maybe within the state, but not New Carlisle. A resolution is not a law. I want anybody to understand, a resolution is not a law. It's just a strong opinion. That's all it's supposed to be, a strong opinion. So.
Mr. Mayor, Mr. Lethley was first.
No, okay. I just was curious to also what's the real basis of this? Because basically it's saying we're going to allow law enforcement to do their job. We support law enforcement by catching speeders, but we don't have a resolution for that. I don't understand. Everybody's against illegal immigration. I understand that. But what does this really do for us? What's the purpose of this, I guess, other than saying, yep, we're going to obey the law? You know what I mean? You're laughing, but I don't see the difference.
It sounds almost that silly. What you're saying there. Basically, we want to support the county sheriff's office, state, federal, and other law enforcement for illegal activity within our city. Sure. To where if somebody was to come here and illegals as a city or a council or a police department, would I have stopped?
Would we stop them if we didn't have this resolution? I'm just asking, would we stop them if we didn't have this resolution?
Hold on.
No, just that was just a question. I'm not contradicting what you're saying. I'm not saying this is a bad idea. I just want to know, what is this necessary? Is, I guess, the question.
All I can say is, Mr. Lethley, if you don't think it's necessary, you can vote against it.
That's a cop out. I mean you're bringing it here with obviously a purpose, and that's great. If there's reasoning behind it, that's great. What's the purpose? That's all. Other than restating what's written here, I understand what's written.
Right.
But I am not for illegal immigration. Don't get me wrong. At
I'm
all.
Not either. I don't know really of any illegals that we have here.
Nor do I. Nor do I.
You know, I know a lot of legal.
I deal with them every
here.
Week. I deal with
we
them every week.
Right.
Seriously, and they're great people.
We have a lot of them right over there by us.
Absolutely, you know? We do. Great people.
Yeah, they are.
Great neighbors.
They are. But with that said, I still think we have illegal people and activity in our city that are concerned.
No, I said.
Let them know that we're not going to tolerate it. They think we are.
I guess I'm just cautioning on the side of I do not in any way, shape, or form want to disrespect the good, hardworking, honest, legal immigrants that are here by saying New Cross City Council said something against immigrants.
I don't want that.
I know it doesn't. Yeah. You know it doesn't. Yeah. I want to make sure that the Hispanic community understands we love you.
And they come here legally, I have no problem with anybody. Because okay. This whole country is starting out with
absolutely.
Immigrants.
I'm an immigrant.
You know, if all the immigrants left, the Indians Bureau has.
Okay.
Mr. Reynolds.
It's hard to follow up on that. But I think, you know, with Attorney General Sessions saying that funding is going to be removed from cities that declare sanctuary status, I think we need to stand out and say, hey.
So is that a protection for that?
I think that's how I would read it, yeah. Okay. I mean, especially with Cincinnati Choir, that Attorney General Sessions said, hey, we're going to take those monies away from those sanctuary cities. Well, I want New Carlisle to be in front of the queue for those monies to be given.
We don't get much
more.
Thank you, Mr. Reynolds. Mr. Lowe.
Okay. I don't think I'm wrong. Matter of fact, I'm dead sure I'm right. The definition of a resolution is that we are all in agreement if we vote yes.
Yes.
Therefore, I think when I first heard about this, I thought it was an ordinance, and I did set against it. Because there's already law in place, and it tells you what the law is right here under the United States Code. So if we vote yes on it, all we're saying is we're actually in agreement with the Nationality Act as codified in the United States Code, United States USC. It's just a wording agreement with that. We're not enforcing anything. We're not unenforcing anything. We are just in agreement as a county. That's all the resolution is. It's resolution is that we all agree. It's saying that we agree with this top part, which is already a law. This is a law. This is just that we agree with the law. That's all resolution is. We're agreeing.
Thank you, Mr. Lauer. Anyone else?
Kind of, when I was reading it, and Mr. Lefley kind of hit on it, I would be really worried, and again, I'm not for legal immigrants by any way, but I would be really worried that any immigrants might be offended by reading it. So if we pass it or if we don't pass it, does it change anything that we already are doing?
Exactly.
So, okay.
Other than that sanctuary. I understand that.
Yeah,
I understand that.
So how realistic is the sanctuary thing coming into your life?
Hold on.
You know, who's being protected by the sanctuary? Okay. Yeah, he don't agree with detail about it. You said Cincinnati, because they pass a resolution like this, then they won't be known as a sanctuary.
They will be
yeah. Sanctuary city. So then
which what sanctuary city does is if someone were to be an illegal immigrant or not purposely breaking the law in any way, shape, or form, all this does is just allow people to talk with local law enforcement, the state, and federal, which you do almost at any other form in government whatsoever. I mean, if you're a great example is the blitz we just had here in Clark County. It's the best example. We literally had state, local, and then U.S. Marshals here, federal officials working hand in hand, going through and arresting people who were drug dealers and whatever they were. And the warrants, I mean, a lot of them were illegal immigrants. They were just people as you and I just sitting on. We're sitting here under the drugs, but you know, they were. So I mean, yeah, I mean, this is how I see it. Is you know, here in the Cincinnati Inquirer, it even says this is not even a good newspaper for conservatives to use, unfortunately, but because you know, the city of Cincinnati would violate federal law and put all their funds in jeopardy. That's a quote from the paper. I mean, that's going to be a problem if that money does happen to get taken away from Cincinnati and Columbus and Cleveland and San Francisco and whatever other city there might be in this country or here in Ohio. I think that we would like to be right in front of the queue for Attorney General Sessions. Hey, here's some extra money. Because we probably get zero federal funds.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Reynolds. Anyone else on council? Call for a vote, Mr. Collier.
Is the motion to approve?
Yeah, but the motion is to approve. Mr. Rick Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. Lefley.
No.
Mr. Krabacher.
No.
Mayor Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds.
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay.
Yes.
Mr. Leidy.
By no means is this a slap in the face, or do I have any ill towards feelings towards immigrants by any means, but just to state that we will work with the police department, yes.
Resolution 17-05 passes 5-2.
Thank you, sir. Continuing on when you're ready.
Resolution 17-06R, introduction, public hearing, and action tonight. A resolution amending Resolution 1503R, appointing representatives to the Transportation Coordinating Committee.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Reynolds.
Move to approve Resolution 17-06R.
Second. Is that Mr. Reynolds?
Mr. Lindsay.
Yes.
And Mr. Lindsay. All right, so the explanation of this resolution, we have TCC, Transportation Coordinating Committee, We have, we had an old council member who's now a county commissioner, was on that board with us. Since now, Will McLaughlin is a county commissioner, we do need to replace his spot. So Vice Mayor John Kriegbacher has been going in his spot, but we do need council to make that official and to permanently put him in that. And this term ends December 31st, 2018. And it is just a basically a TCC board member. They have a meeting. Is it monthly, sir?
Yes.
Monthly, they'll go. They'll pass the legislation that they have on the ballot. They'll learn about some other projects going on in the county. It's actually really informative to go to. But we do need a resolution in place to support Mr. Kriegbacher now being that member and Mr. Leffley being an alternative.
Any discussion? Are you ready, sir?
Mr. Leidy?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Leffley?
Yes.
Mr. Kriegbacher?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Resolution 1706R passes 7-0.
Thank you, sir.
Give me a second, Mayor. Resolution 17-07R, introduction, public hearing, and action tonight. A resolution appointing members to the Tax Incentive Review Council.
Council?
Mr. Mayor, we appoint resolution 17-07R.
Second.
Is that Mr. Leidy?
Yes, sir.
And an explanation of this resolution, again, we have another situation to our former mayor, Will McLaughlin, is now our county commissioner. And he was on the Tax Incentive Review Council for me, and this is actually a cool review council to be on. Clark County has an enterprise zone. So basically, if you have a specific type of business and you want to put it in Clark County, or more importantly, in our case, the city limits of New Carlisle, we'll give you X amount of tax abatement if you create so many jobs and generate so much revenue in the time period that stays. So one of the cool things about this one is being a member of this board, once a year we go to the county and we review every enterprise zone agreement that's in the county. Have they hired enough people? Have they met their general obligations as far as development, as far as building size? Have they had that much sales? So we are that board that says yes they did or no they did not. I don't think I've ever came across one where they haven't fulfilled their obligation. But since Commissioner McLaughlin is now with the county, we do need to replace his spot. I did reach out to Councilman Lindsay. He has agreed to take that spot if council does approve that spot.
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Council, any discussion? When you're ready, Mr. Collier.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Leffley?
Yes.
Ms. Kriegbacher?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Leidy?
Yes.
Resolution 17-07R passes 7-0.
Thank you, sir. Moving on to ordinances. One with action, two introduction.
Give me a second.
Yes, sir.
Ordinance 1712, public hearing in action tonight. An ordinance amending the City of New Carlisle's use of city-owned vehicle policy.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to make a motion on ordinance 17-12.
Second.
I have a motion by Mr. Kriegbacher and a second by Mr. Leffler.
And an explanation of this ordinance. We had some discussion not letting deputies take their car or someone who wants to be deputy. How it states now, if you are a New Carlisle deputy, you're actually a Clark County Sheriff. What we do is we contract out with Clark County to get some deputies here in the city. We have a total of four. So basically these public service employees, they will drive their own personal car to work, hop in the cruiser, and then go about their day-to-day new routine. Well, we do want to put a push on there that will allow them to actually take our patrol vehicle home with them. And that will allow them to clean it, take care of it, maintenance it on their own time. There was a previous policy set that limited it to 10 miles outside the city limits. So right now the thing is in front of council to allow them to take it outside of the county if we have a mutual agreement with the sheriff, because it is the sheriff's name on the car, but also to increase that from a 10-mile radius to 20-mile radius. another aspect of this thing too is when you look at the makeup of New Carlisle, we don't have any major highways coming through here. I think the top speed limit is probably 35, maybe 55 if you go out on 235. So allowing the deputies to get in that car and, I hate to say it, rev it up to 60, 65, 70, actually does a little good for that engine. So it is all about public safety. It's about response times. If we have an emergency, now that deputy does not have to go to the police station to get their car first. They can immediately get the car direct straight from the house. So there's a lot of pros with this particular method. Any questions you have pertaining to that, you can address council. But it is up for vote tonight for council to approve or deny.
Mr. Lowry.
I do have a question.
Mm-hmm.
Past city manager, this policy was enforced and she canceled. When I questioned her, and she said, well, Rick, I found out that while the deputies are off duty, the car is not insured.
That's not
I said, well, they're on duty 24 hours a day. And she said, I'll get back with you. It was less than 20 minutes she got back with me, and she said, insurance company says if they're not being paid, the car is not insured. Have you checked into that? I didn't believe it then, but I want to make sure that this car is insured wherever.
As long as they are driving our vehicle, they are insured. Okay. It doesn't matter if it's before shift, after shift, they're on the way. They are a law enforcement officer. The moment they get in that car to do work, they're on duty. And it doesn't matter where that location is.
I will take your word for that.
Sure.
Will one of these be leaving the county?
Yes.
Whereabouts?
Champaign County.
Champaign County. Mm-hmm.
Just right over the city limits. I don't know that northern part, but it's, I don't want to put them on the spot. I think it's maybe five.
I think it's like a mile and a half.
Mile and a half outside the city limits. I mean, county limits. I do apologize.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure.
Council, any other questions?
I think. to address just a little bit, I think in the ordinance that the sheriff, if it was an issue, the sheriff would discuss that. So if it's beyond that,
right.
There's going to be a discussion.
I thought that all along, but I just wanted to make sure.
Now, you guys need to understand that is a policy derivative. That should have never came from your city manager. That should have came from the council.
Right, and it did originally, but when she said they weren't covered under insurance, when it came to a home.
Yeah.
Okay.
When you're ready, sir.
Mr. Krabacher.
Yes.
Mayor Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Leidy?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Lethley?
Yes.
Ordinance 1712 passes 7-0.
First and second round. So.
Motion, Graybacher, second round.
I think today was one of those examples to where I didn't put included in the second packet. Is everybody still okay with that?
Yeah.
We're good? Okay.
I shuffled.
I know. That's why I asked. I'm listening. Are we still on the same page?
Okay.
I can start putting them back in.
It's on my desk.
Ordinance 17-13, introduction tonight, public hearing, and will be discussed and have action on at the next meeting, 4-17-17. An ordinance setting transfer date as provided in Memorandum of Understanding for Bell Manor donation. Ordinance 17-14, introduction tonight, public hearing in action at the next meeting on 4-17-17. An ordinance providing authority for proclamations. That's all I have, Mayor.
Thank you, sir. Before we jump down to other business, I wanted to add one. There's a lot of students in here tonight. We're looking for summer jobs and want to be a lifeguard, and you file forward looking for lifeguards. So if you guys can stop by the city building, give them a call, or you can shoot the New Carlisle Pools Facebook page and message, and they will help you out with that information.
Just think of the nice suntan we'll get.
And get paid to get it. Other business.
I'll do it. Crime Watch meeting will be held on Wednesday, April the 12th. It begins at 6:30 p.m. and it'll be here at Smith Park Shelter House, and it is open to the public. Congressman Warren Davison will hold mobile office hours here at the City Building on the fourth Tuesday of each month, and that is from 2 p.m. to 2:30. And city offices will be closed on Good Friday, April the 14th. That's all I have, Mayor.
Thank you, sir. Any other discussion, council, before we finish up?
Mr. Briz?
Yes, sir.
Did you have a letter that we were all to sign?
I do not have that with me.
Okay.
I do apologize, and you are absolutely correct.
Okay, it's fine.
I will own that mistake 150%.
Not that you didn't have other issues to think of.
Good, Mr. Leslie?
No, I just totally forgot to put it on my calendar.
Thank you.
That needs to go tomorrow.